Welcome to an episode of Prepper Talk Radio, Radio for the Ready Minded, where we focus on God, family, and country. You've got Scott, Shane, and Paris in the house today, your hosts. We're here to talk to you about some things that we think are important, we think are special, we think are awesome. If there's any topics that you want to hear from us about, please shoot us an email at preppertalkradio@gmail.com and or join our Facebook group at on Facebook. We have it. It's called Emergency Prep and Self-Reliance. It's a great group. We got, we're closing in on 1,500 people in there, I think. Mm-hmm. And it's mm-hmm. got a lot of activity, a lot of great interaction and sharing back and forth. In this video, we're going to have you remind you that our affiliate ITM Trading is one of our faves. I'm actually going to be meeting with them tomorrow to go over a few things that they're doing that are coming out that are new. So please check out learn.itmtrading.com. And this is a gold and silver. What they do is if you have what they focus on is if you have an old IRA or an old 401k or an old something like that sitting there, there's self-directed IRAs or self-directed options that you can choose. Our recommendation as unfinancial advisor recommendation is that you put your money mm-hmm. in gold and silver. And if you can, what will happen is if you call the number that's scrolling along the bottom of the screen right now, if you're on YouTube, if you're not on YouTube, that phone number is 1-866-257-0481. That's 1-866-257-0481. That number is our number. Like when you call, they'll know it's Prepper Talk Radio that you got that number from, and they will go through a 30-ish minute free consultation. And they'll give you a rundown. They'll look at your particular goals and how it fits into your financial situation. They'll tell you what they have to offer. And if it's a fit, you move forward. It's free and there's no obligation. So again, it's 1-866-257-0481. And with that, we're going to actually talk a little bit on this episode about the importance of, well, we've already talked about gold and silver a lot, but we're going to talk about gold and silver again today. But we're going to kind of do it with a little bit of a twist where we're going to talk a little bit about how we can use gold and silver in the future for bartering. You know, when the economy changes, and I hope you heard me say when the economy changes, not if the economy mm-hmm. changes. When the economy changes, we're going to need to have resources that are different than the fiat currency that we have now to be able to get the goods and services that we need. And one of, by the way, the best ways to do that is with gold and silver. Because the value is there. It's intrinsic value within the actual material that you can trade that. And it's what's cool about gold and silver is that it's valuable all around the world, no matter mm-hmm. what community, no matter what society, no matter where you are, everybody recognizes gold has value. Everybody recognizes silver has value. So you don't have to worry about exchange rates and all this other fiat currency nonsense that we have to deal with. Mm-hmm. So we're gonna chat for a minute, but we're gonna start off the hour here with a little bit of the history of gold, why we feel like gold is important, at least as part of your portfolio for sure. And then we're going to spend the bulk of the time talking about some of the ways that we can use to barter it.
So, yeah, and one of the reasons why I wanted to talk about gold and silver today is because the recent action in the markets. Gold has hit all-time highs in U.S. dollars. It's been breaking highs in other currencies all around the world for the past couple of years, just not so much in U.S. dollars. But it's finally happened. It's over. It actually got over $2,200 one day. It didn't close above it there, but we're pushing on that door. And I expect a lot more. I see this more as a floor than a ceiling. There's a long mm-hmm. way for it to go. And it's just kind of being ignored. People aren't really talking about it, except for us gold bugs and silver bugs, right? We see what's happening. And we see it happening while the stock market is also going up at the same time. And that doesn't usually happen, right? The question about interest rates is still hanging in the air. It's going to stay higher for longer, in my opinion. But as Parrish was saying, there's a tremendous amount of history with gold and silver. And the best way, in my opinion, to protect yourself, to secure your wealth through the turmoil in the markets that we're going to see is right here, gold and silver.
Yep. And for those of you who are watching on YouTube, you'll see collection there in front of me. I got a few things here that I've got in front of me. The cameras doesn't allow me to have it in front of me, but I'll kind of show some things.
This is a fraction. That looks like he borrowed everything from Scrooge McDuck. I'm totally joking. But the point is like we have all been investing in gold and silver to different degrees, right? Mm-hmm. Shane's at a point where he's built his own bank system, right? He doesn't take loans out. He borrows from himself and pays himself back, right?
That's correct.
That is far and away a much better way to live than trusting in a banking system that you can't even go to withdraw your money when you need to. Like, mm-hmm. have you been to the bank and tried to pull out more than $1,000 in a day? If the answer is yes, tell me how long it took. I tried to pull out $3,000 a few months ago. It took 5 days for them to have $3,000.
Yeah, I haven't done that for a while. So it's that's it's just ridiculous. It is. It's ridiculous. This is my currency. I'm not going to say money because gold and silver are money. Mm-hmm. Dollars are currency, right? So let's mm-hmm. make sure to get that right up front here, because this is money. Dollars are currency, right? They're actually a debt. And a debt note is what they are.
It's a debt note. And having those resources on hand is like this, or even better, in an actual coin. It's safer going into the changing economy than having it anywhere else. And that's my personal feeling. Not a financial advisor. Someone who's trying to be hedged against all the possible scenarios that we could come up against.
So just a brief, quick history of gold and silver and fiat currency. For thousands of years, gold and silver has been a medium of exchange for value for goods and services. Thousands of years. If you want to really get a detailed breakdown, we highly recommend Mike Maloney, M-A-L-O-N-E-Y, Mike Maloney. Mm-hmm. He's got a fantastic channel. Another great one, by the way, is, and I highly recommend, this is actually on YouTube, and I'll probably find them and put them in the show notes so you guys can have access to it. But another great one was done recently by the hedge fund manager, Ray Dalio. He put a huge, it's like a 45-minute video, totally worth the watch. And he went through actually how world reserve currencies have risen and fallen over the last 500-600 years. So what happens is whenever a world reserve currency starts out, it's usually after a kinetic event, kinetic meaning a war. What it does is they establish a new currency based on gold and silver reserves, like whatever that new country or society or economy has as gold and silver. The gold then is too hard to carry around, it's too bulky, it's too, all these things, weighs too much, all that stuff. So what they then do is the next phase is they create notes against the gold so that you can you can transfer the notes, and then anytime you need it, you can take those notes down to the bank, and then you can get your gold if you want to. Then over time, what happens is these notes become more and more easily available, and it's more tradable, and people trust the notes instead of the actual gold that it's backed up by. And then, like we see in ancient Rome, the denar, I think it was the denari, was slowly but surely they took the silver out of it and traded it with cheaper, more common metals, and they slowly degraded
the actual coins as well. Yeah,
and that's part of, if you look at the different history lessons of how Rome fell, that was one of the reasons, was that degradation of their currencies and their monies. So in the 70s, when we see the United States, who was and is currently, and according to Ray Dalio, we're holding on to it by a thread, the world reserve currency of the dollar right now, we dropped the gold backing of our dollar. And so that literally became a fiat currency. It's a fiat currency means there's nothing backing it except for maybe the good faith, the military, our might. Mm-hmm. Those are those things. There's actually no intrinsic value within the bill itself, and there's nothing backing it other than what we've talked about already. And the fiat currency lifespan is typically 50 to, what would you say, Shane? 50 to 100 years, maybe? 75?
100 years max, really more like 40 to 70, 80 years, yeah.
Yeah, usually. And so if in the 70s, we dropped the gold backing and we're a fiat currency in the 70s, we're 2024 today. Mm-hmm. We're literally 54 years into the life cycle, and they don't go much longer. So we're right there, due for and primed for. In fact, I think it was official we went dropped the gold standard in the 70s, but I think there were some things that happened even before that. So it really makes us further along in the life cycle. So that's where we're talking about. And then the reality of, I mean, I was talking to another buddy the other day, and he was telling me, like, Paris, you can't even go to, like, they won't even give you change cash, coins at Starbucks anymore. Some of them, most of them.
Oh, I've heard that. Yeah, I've heard that.
And there's other stores now that are doing the same thing. Like, what's happening? Like,
yeah, what I've got here is a 1964 quarter. This is 90% silver. So the U.S. government did default back in 1933 when they basically said, turn in your gold and we'll give you $20 an ounce. That's a default. That is taking the currency off the dollar. And then in 1964, this was the last year that they put silver into any of our currency. This is actually money because this is 90% silver.
Did I get the date wrong, Payne?
No, you're right. 1971 is when Nixon took the U.S. off the gold standard, right? They said, we will no longer convert the U.S. dollar into gold for foreign countries, right? Mm. And so essentially that's a default. But this in 1964 is when they stopped the last year of putting silver in our money. This is money, and that's a default as well. And so at that point, our currency was off the silver standard and off the gold standard. Technically, when Nixon temporarily sustained the gold convertibility window, and we've been fiat ever since, and that's what has allowed the debt to grow so incredibly quickly since then.
Mm-hmm. And I know, Scott, you had, I actually only read a lot of things about it, but I actually never read the book, The Creature of Jekyll Island. But I know, Scott, you've talked about how the Federal Reserve, when they came in, and some of the things they did. You want to talk about that for a second?
The Creature from Jekyll Island, it's a fantastic read. It's a deep, heavy read. It's very data-backed, and tons of research went into creating this book. But it basically talks about the entire creation of the Federal Reserve and how the whole goal was to get us off gold and silver so they could control it and they could create debt notes, which is the fiat currency we use, to then collapse society and reset it with their own measure again and again and again and again. It's not a U.S.-based institution. It's just not.
It's not a federal. There's no reserve.
They lied to Congress to get it established, saying that it would be part of the U.S. institution, and yet it never was. Congress voted for it, and nothing that was ever promised ever was fulfilled. So we sit in a situation where we're using fiat currency, which fiat is basically, and we're not talking about the car, guys. It's not the fiat. It's
by decree.
And that wasn't a good car anyways, but it just means it's fake. It's not real. It's not tied to anything.
It's counterfeit is the right word.
It's counterfeit.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, in a world of fake news, we're dealing with fake money.
But the creature from Jekyll Island actually identifies, you know, how this all works, how it all breaks down, but how it's going to fail. And it goes to history to look at, okay, how did Rome fail? Well, because they went off the gold standard and the silver standards. Like, as you depart from that and create fake money, right, which is just currency, when you create that currency, it never has a long life. It's typically about 50 years, and then it's gone. And so they start over. And it's always whoever's in power creates the new standard and the new laws, and then you have to go exchange everything and rebuild, and don't fall for it. Get prepared and get organized. Yeah. And that's why this conversation is so important today, is not just understanding where the money comes from, money, gold and silver, but how to use it in the future.
Yeah. Money. One of the things that most of you will know is that Federal Reserve is a fake name. It makes you feel like it has government backing, but it's not. Federal is their name of a corporate. It's a corporation. It's not actually a government entity. And anyways, if you go down that rabbit hole, you'll find a lot of fun stuff. So I'd highly recommend you do it, but we're not doing it on this show today.
Yeah, absolutely.
I wanted to quickly show this video. You guys okay if we kind of use this video as a transition for the
100%.
Oh yeah, go ahead.
So there's this cool video. This is a video of a good friend of ours. His name is Kevin, and he is one of the I think he's the COO of Goldback. And you know, we've talked about Goldbacks. We've had Jeremy on. We've had Benjamin on. We've had some people on talking about Goldbacks. We love Goldbacks. We'll use Goldbacks. We're going to share some Goldback stuff here. But he is speaking at an event, and he kind of shares something that's pretty real and legit about the value of what gold really does in terms of its strength. It's not an investment where you can have it grow like a stock or a bond. but it is a hedge against inflation, and it will track with inflation. And if you've got a dollar bill sitting in a savings account doing nothing, it would be better served that you turn that dollar bill into a gold something, because that gold something is going to far outdo what anything that that dollar bill can do. And you'll, and he will have you, this is good. So let's go.
If any of you had $1 million in cash in 1972, it would take you $7.1 million today to purchase the same amount of goods that you could have purchased in 1972. $7.1 million. Now, if you had $1 million in gold in 1972, that gold would be worth $7.1 million today. So purchasing gold is a great hedge against inflation, but it doesn't put you ahead the way some other investments will. And that's where our leasing opportunity comes in.
I love that. You just laid it out so simply.
Yeah, and we can even go further back in history, all the way back to Rome. You know, there's the example, it's, I guess, kind of a lame example overused, that an ounce of gold would used to buy a an entire wardrobe for a Greek, a toga, the sandals, everything. And now keep in mind, it took an entire month to make that fabric. So it's really was a month's worth of income back then. And now it's, you know, a gold at 2100, close to 2200, it's undervalued. A month's income right now, I mean, it varies, but gold is far undervalued at this point.
Well, the interesting thing too is, have you tried to buy a high quality suit?
No, like I don't get
suit, that. Suit, tie, shirt, shoes, you combine all that, you're around $2,000 if you go custom made, right? Doesn't have to be the high end, right? But a custom made suit, you're going to be in that $1,500 to $2,000 range, which is interesting because that was the benchmark for the 1 ounce of gold in Rome. Was you're getting a custom toga with sash, with cloak, and sandals. Same thing, same setup. And yet now, if you were to try to buy food, you can't even buy food the same. Right. Mm-hmm. If you had gold, you could buy a lot more food than what we're buying based off of our dollar with the inflation.
But Scott, they don't accept gold at the grocery store.
That's okay.
That's what we hear, right? That's
right. Yeah, but there's a window. There's a time.
They don't right now, but that's why Goldbacks is that's one of the strengths of Goldbacks is they have that transactionable, mm-hmm. Small enough amounts of gold that they're transactionable. I mean, when I first started buying my Goldbacks and using them, they were $3 and they were just under $4. And if you go to goldback.com today, it looks like it's right around $4.60. So even the Goldback as a value has gone up quite a bit. And here's an example of a Goldback. I mean, we're going to have links in the description if you want to get some Goldbacks from us and from Alpine Gold. These are fantastic opportunity. When I go to the grocery store, when I go to a local business and I tell them, hey, look, I'd like to buy your service in gold or your product in gold. They're going to look at me like, wait, what? Like, how do I give you change for that? I'm like, no. I mean, you can give them an ounce. And the good news is there's quarter ounces and 10th ounces and half ounces. So you can break it down. So, I mean, the lowest real ounce stacking that you would get is maybe a 10th ounce, but that's still $200. Mm-hmm. So if you're going to transact something that's less than $200, you got to figure out the change. Well, the 1 ounce, 1/1000th of an ounce of Goldback is $4.60. So that's a way lower. You can buy, you know, what you can buy something for $5 practically. And a lot of these people are like, oh shoot, I'll just take the one. I'll take the difference because it's gold. It's cool. So you can get a discount by bartering sometimes. And that's the cool thing about, and by the way, we're going to talk about bartering more, but bartering is something we can do today, like right now. Like, you don't have to just go into a store and accept what they say is the price. I mean, well, most stores, but big box stores for sure. Like, but if I actually went to, I've been to my mechanic actually. He's like, this is the price. I'm like, hey, bro, can I get like a good buddy discount or something? Like, yeah, we're not going to run the coupon for a little while, but I'll give you the coupon discount now, you know? So I, so to speak, barter even today. you know, and I get deals. My wife looks at me and sometimes she's embarrassed because I'm always trying to barter and get a better deal. But then she's like, I don't know. It worked. Like, I don't know how, like, I would never ask. I'm too embarrassed to ask, but you asked and it worked. I'm like, yeah, why not? You don't get a deal unless you ask. Yeah.
It's funny because if we're doing like a garage sale, you're always willing to barter. If you're doing like Facebook Marketplace, you're always willing to barter. You'll nickel and dime each other. You'll negotiate. But that's like the winning area of society that we've all forgotten. And I think it's really more Americans have forgotten to negotiate. Mm-hmm. Anytime I go across the border, especially if I go south, or if I've gone, like I've got family went to Europe recently and they're like, man, everywhere you go, it is a fun purchasing experience because you're going back and forth on price and you're finding something that works for everybody. Whereas here we've been indoctrinated that the price is the price. Mm-hmm. But you can still try.
Well, especially over the last couple of years when there were shortages, everything was in very high demand. You know, the mm-hmm. price of vehicles in particular, they put a premium on everything and basically said, pay it or don't, you know, or get lost, right? That's changed. And that is continuing to change with interest rates going up, with a lot of different factors we won't get into. It's getting a lot easier to actually get deals and make deals, right? To hold your grounds on things you need, right?
Yeah.
Well, what's crazy is it takes practice. It takes practice.
I was shopping yesterday and my family likes the, from time to time, we'll get the mashed potatoes. We normally get real potatoes, peel them and boil them and smash them up, but we needed something real quick. So we got instant potatoes. It was $1.44. I remember when it was 98 cents, like in the last year, like 2021, mm-hmm. 22, like it was 98 cents. So from 98 cents to $1.44, my $1 bill stayed the same. My $1 bill stayed the same. Mm-hmm. The price of goods has gone up. That's where we get tricked. Like we think, oh, a dollar didn't change. No, you're right. It did. You're right. The dollar itself didn't change. What it can buy changed. But right. If I had 98 cents worth of gold back in 2020 and inflation was that from 98 cents to $1.44, my value of gold that was 98 cents will now be $1.44, and I can use the same amount of gold to buy that instant mashed potatoes. Yeah. That's well, think the power of, it a, of gold and silver.
Yeah, I think of it a slightly different way is that the inflation is actually a decrease in the value of the dollar, right? As they print more dollars, they're devaluing every other dollar that's out there. So yes, gold will hold its value based in US dollars, but also think that inflation, the price is, you're referring to potatoes. I remember Baker potatoes have basically gone up 100% in the last year. I do a lot of shopping, but it's actually the value of the dollar that is losing value. It's not, if you kind of picture that the value of something stays the same, the value of potato is always the same. The value of say gold is always the same. But how are you denominating that, right? If an ounce of gold bought a suit, bought a toga back in Rome, and it can buy a $2,000 suit now, that's kind of, like I said before, it's kind of a bad example, not a great example. There are better examples, but let's go back to Rome. The denarius was about a tenth of an ounce of silver. If you look at this here, this is a dime. That's close to a tenth of an ounce. So that was the daily wage for a Roman soldier. It was a tenth of an ounce of silver. And now how much does a tenth of an ounce of silver cost? That's about $2. Would you work $2 for a day? No, absolutely not. It's the value of the currency that's gone down, not the value of the metal.
Yeah.
So it will return. It will return to that norm. And people will be glad to work for a tenth of an ounce of silver for a day in the near future.
So let's talk, let's kind of shift gears and let's talk barter and trade using our gold and silver in the change coming forward. This is, I think a lot of you listeners are probably like, okay, that's what I want to know. How do I now use this to my advantage going forward?
Mm-hmm. I get a lot of flack with people about that tell me that, hey, when crap hits the fan, nobody's going to care about gold and silver. All they're going to want to care about is food. And right. So I highly recommend that before you go get gold and silver, you get your food. However, if you do have gold and silver, that's a great thing to barter for. Like if you walk into somebody's, up to someone's place or house, or maybe they're a vegetable garden or something, you have gold and they have food, you'll be able to say, hey, look, how much gold will you take for those ears of corn or those potatoes or those types of things? That's something in the near future. I actually remember an old story of a guy that was a young man, and he was helping his grandpa put, you know, cans on the shelf. And his grandpa turns to this young man and says, there will come a day when somebody will give you their car for a can of beans to be able to eat, because the car will be worthless and the can of beans will be worth everything. That, I mean, that's kind of the idea of bartering, is that you will give up something of value that you feel is of equal value to what they're giving you. And so though, I would say the first thing that people would barter gold and silver for is food items. And especially people who are growing their own food, gardeners, farmers, things like that. I think that would be a real easy example of how you can even do it today. Like, there's farmers markets you can go to, and you can say, hey, how many, that's where the Goldback is kind of flourishing right now, is there's a lot of these people like, hey, how much for, you know, 5 years of corn or 10 years of corn? Like, oh, that's $5. How about one Goldback? Oh yeah, sure. Yeah. Oh wow. That's cool. You know, so you can make deals where you, that's the idea, is you barter back and forth until you both agree on a value.
And one of the things I foresee, and this is, so going off history, the history has been that, like, once that monetary system fails, we reset to the new gold, to a new gold standard again, right? But what we miss is that kind of that in-between phase, like what really happens to barter and trade and the economy in that in-between phase, right? Mm-hmm. As that currency's dissolving, you'll see more product for product trade for a while, but you'll also see the gold value going through the roof with institutions. That's how it's worked in the past. That's history repeats itself. So I recognize that gold and silver are going to go through the roof in price value in that interim phase. And that's a good opportunity time to, in my opinion, okay, I've got all this gold and silver, I've got all my food, I've got all this other stuff taken care of. I'm going to take a chunk of that gold and silver and I'm going to pay off all my debts, right? Be free and clear on my house, be free and clear on whatever else I need to be free and clear on. And then look to the daily interaction and transactional use of gold and silver as we start regaining our communities.
Because, a little bit of normalcy, right?
Yeah. Grocery stores aren't going to exist in that rebuilding phase, right? We're going to go into a community. Everyone's got like their little booths, like a farmer's market. That's in a collapse situation.
Mad Max Bartertown.
You know, and it'll be fantastic. It's not going to be like Mad Max, I don't believe. I think it's going to be more like old town ways. Like small town stuff.
You go to third world countries, not even third world countries, but just go out of a lot of places outside the United States, they call it the market. We see how many movies do we see where the bad guy is going to meet the other guy in the marketplace, you know, and you see the tents around there and it's like Aladdin, you know, and it's all the different shops that are there. That's going on today. Of course, it was still thousands of years ago. That's like happening today in other countries where the village or the city, the town, you all kind of meet in the middle. Everybody puts up their, you know, so to speak, their tent, their booth, and they sell their goods and services. Whether it's, hey, I'm the carving guy, I can make you a carving of some kind, or corn guy, I'm the apple guy, I'm the orange guy. You know, who knows? Like, you go down there and you say, hey, hire me to go, you know, plow your field for the day, and that's your booth. You know, there's services that can be done as well as goods, and that's kind of what I see. Is more of that kind of thing happening once we start getting in, if we do get that. And by the way, Scott, my first thing is, will we even need to pay off our debts if the crap hits the fan? Like, maybe the institutions won't even be around. However, let's just pretend for a minute they are. Negotiate, bro. Like, do you think that mortgage company is going to be like, man, you're the only guy with any kind of gold. Yes, I'll take whatever you got. We'll be good. You know what I mean? You could probably get half off your mortgage because you got hard assets to bring to the table. You know what I mean?
Which just means that gold... Yeah, gold just has much higher value than what the posted prices, right? So right now, we know that gold and silver the value is established by futures trading, by trading paper futures for the next month's contract of, okay, I want to buy gold in April and here's my price. And so that's where gold is set, but it's set by paper printing. But not to get too much far into that, what I wanted to bring up is that, yes, I think it is a possibility to where there could be some event to where all of a sudden gold and silver is no good, right? I think that's very unlikely. I think it's a very low possibility that there's a big EMP and then something, and then the world goes to Mad Max immediately, and then gold and silver is worth nothing until maybe coming out the other end of whatever that is. I don't think that's going to be the case. I think it's going to be more like what you guys are saying is our financial system is collapsing right now, and it's happening, and gold and silver is starting to show it. And I believe it's going to take off rapidly. Who knows when? That's the whole question. What's the timing of this? And so I believe there will be a time when there will be a transition to CBDCs, right? Central bank digital currencies. I don't think they're going to like gold and silver. I don't think we're going to be able to transfer any or very little of that into that system and have those types of credits or, you know, US right. CBDC currency, whatever it is. But I believe there will be a time to where, like you said there, Paris, I'm going to go pay off my mortgage. I'm going to go pay off whatever debts I might have, because gold and silver will be the premium bartering or trading money. And so, yeah, we'll take your U.S. sovereign coins to pay off your mortgage or pay down or whatever. And that's why I think where my initial plan is to take those and hopefully the bank will say, yes, you know, we want your gold, we want your silver. And then from there, I personally will spend it very quickly on items that I really need, on necessities, and retain a certain amount of silver in particular so that I can barter with that. And if the world goes south so fast that I can't barter with it, I'm not going to feel so bad that I'm sitting on a lot of silver or gold, because I'm going to use it as quickly as there I can. At first,
we had most of you who've been listening for a little bit know that we had Angry American on Chris Weatherman on a couple episodes ago. In his book, Going Home, it was that first book. I remember the guy was traveling home and he had some silver coins on him, and he went into a store, and it was a local store. And the guy, he walked up and said, "Hey, how much for these?" He's like, "We're not taking anything but gold and silver." And he's like, "That's fine. I got some silver coins." And he was able to get a few items from that store because the store owner was aware. He was a local businessman, and he was aware that, you know, things were not good, and probably money that he knew was not going to be worth anything. So he switched quickly to silver only and gold only, precious metals only. And thankfully in the book, Angry American had written into that book that the character had some silver coins and was able to buy some things from that store. So that's another real thing. Chris Weatherman did his research. Of course, he's not going to just write some book randomly about whatever, but that's a great remembrance to keep in mind about how when things hit, I believe that there's going to be an initial bartering of goods back and forth, like Scott said, where it's food for food, maybe for a little while. And then once there's like a little bit of an established, okay, everything's back to normal, but we don't have dollar bills anymore. We don't have, you know, that kind of Federal Reserve issues anymore. Now what do we trade with? Well,
compelling us to use the CBDC, which there's no privacy to, and I know we're out of time here, guys, but compels to use the CBDC, whereas this is going to give you freedom to make purchases, make transactions outside of the system. So for me, that's really important part of owning precious metals.
Well, the neat thing I like is the biggest thing that got me into buying gold and silver, sorry, I guess I could say buying, getting gold and silver was understanding that where I live, the laws protect gold and silver as actual legal tender. There are right now, the following states have in their laws, gold and silver is legal tender: Arizona, Kansas, Louisiana, Wyoming, Tennessee, Texas, Indiana, South Carolina, Utah, Missouri, and Oklahoma. So you're already in an advantage in those places because banks and institutions have to recognize it because that is the law. Now, you're still going to run into problems just like we are now, where some companies won't take coins. Oh, card only at this location. Well, do what you need to on your own with legal loopholes and whatnot to get that resolved. But the banks will have to take that gold and silver in exchange at any point, because that's the law. They've agreed to it just by opening their doors there. So use that as however you want, but like, you will have an opportunity with gold and silver to barter and to trade as we reestablish our communities after any major event. That's the thing that I'm excited about, because then it's like everything becomes very real and genuine, and you start trading like for like. I mean, I'm not going to just limit it to just gold and silver. Like, I'm buying extra nails and extra screws.
Oh, yeah.
Why? Because where are you going to get that post an SHTF scenario? Mm-hmm. Same thing with lead, like bullets. Same thing with Band-Aids and beans. Like, get extras to use as tradable goods to hedge against those types of disasters.
Yep. Gold is one of several bartering items that we can use. Silver is another one. That's another thing just to remind everybody that if you're looking at smaller transactions, if you want to do the goldbacks, that's fantastic. If you don't, you can use silver. I mean, what's an ounce of silver is about $25 right now. And so that's kind of what, you know, the value will, it will change once we're in a bartering situation. You can get half ounces of silver, you can get quarter ounces of silver, and you can get 10th ounces of silver, which again, if you equate it out, it'd be about $2 or $3, you know,
or grams
of those. So I think for me, a final thought is gold and silver is going to, you're going to be glad you have it when it's time to have it. I promise you that. However, don't go get gold and silver before you get water, before you get food, before you get gear, before you get all the other stuff. Don't, gold and silver is after all of that. And then when you do finally start getting gold and silver, start getting different denominations. Work your way up to the 1 ounce of gold. If you don't have two grand, but you have 400, go buy silver instead. Buy silver first. You know, get different different ounces, get 10th ounce, quarter ounce, half ounce, 1 ounce, 20 ounce, 50, 10 ounces. And Shane's got them in front of him. He's got a 100 ounce bar there. For those that want to have a 100 ounce bar, this is one, a 10 ounce. It's like a tube cube. There's our 10 ounce bars. Shane's got, we actually gave away a 5 ounce bar. The beginning of last year. We ought to do that again. I think we'll get some, figure out a contest and see what we can do to get that going again. That was fun. But, there's different denominations all the way up to 100 ounces. And then you can, of course, if you can afford a full-blown gold bar, boy, you'd be my hero, but I can't afford one of those yet.
What, like a kilo of gold, something like this?
Yeah, dude, that's 32, 33 ounces of gold.
32 ounces, I checked the price today, $71,000.
Yeah, I don't have that.
Kilo of gold bar.
I don't have that. So if you bought Bitcoin, I'm going to say this and I'm done until I close it out. If you bought one Bitcoin when it was $1,000 and now it's 74,000, time to sell that thing and buy 1 kilo of gold.
Totally agree. Absolutely.
Any other final thoughts, guys?
I think just that, just focus on your immediate needs first, then expand.
But get some.
Amen to that. Well, you've been listening to Prepper Talk Radio, Radio for the Ready Minded. Thank you so much. Really, honestly, thank you so much. We hit 20,000, almost 21,000 listener downloads in the last 30 days recently. And that is because of you guys listening to us and all that you're doing to spread the word on preparedness. Thank you so much. Make sure you hit up our good affiliate program at ITM Trading and call that number 1-866-257-0481 for gold IRA, self-directed IRA opportunities. And then go to alpinegold.com. It's in the link below. We're going to put a description below. I can't remember what is off the top of my head. Sorry, but it's in the description. So if you want to go get goldbacks, goldbacks actually does sell coins as well. So Alpine Gold sells coins. So if you want to get some goldbacks and some coins there individually, that's your place to go. Click the link in the description below and support the show. Thank you so much. Have a great day, and we'll talk to you in the next one.
See you next week.